I've hurt some people along this journey, and vice versa because of that. I got hurt myself and trusted people that I shouldn't have. I do believe, like, the words that are coming out of your mouth, but it's almost like I have no choice, that I have to trust you. Because this is my last drop to try to fix and so I guess my answer is, I think I have no choice but to trust you.
Why are you guys sitting near me? All right. Hi, I'm Brian Herzlinger, and we're here to help me get a date with Drew Barrymore. Am I bulging anywhere? Am I right?
Turn around. Fine.
Probably 4 years now, I've been working on a film called My Date with Hugh. It's a comedy documentary about how an average guy could get invited to the Playboy Mansion and meet Hugh Hefner. I kind of got the idea. There was a movie before mine called My Date with Drew. Great flick about how a guy trying to pursue his lifelong dream to get a date with Drew Barrymore. And I kind of just borrowed from that and thought, because he was an average guy, and I thought, how does an average guy get to the Playboy Mansion? As a kid, I guess I was a little hellraiser. Not a bad kid, just couldn't sit still. Guaranteed, I had ADHD. I just didn't know what it was back then. They even put me on Ritalin because I couldn't sit still. I was just all over the place. Like I said, not a bad kid, just wouldn't shut up. Just talk and talk and talk, yeah. So, I think I was normal, I guess. I think every kid's like that. When I was younger, my grandmother used to live in one of those communal not an old age home, but just an apartment complex that only seniors could live in. There was a mall right behind it, and there was a convenience store that actually used to throw out the other Playboys and other magazines at the end of the month when they got the new month in. So I actually used to jump into the dumpster. I know, disgusting. To get the old Playboys just to see. I guess I got into stand-up comedy because I've always been kind of like the funny guy in the group. And then in high school, it kind of got a little bigger. And then in college, I was the guy that always made everyone laugh. And there were some amateur competitions that kind of started coming up around where I went to college. And I started entering them. And I started winning. And it was funny. I wasn't even doing my own material. I was stealing other people's material and doing it, because I do nothing about writing comedy back then. And but I started winning these competitions, and then it just gradually over the years I do more competitions and then do some shows here and there, and then yeah, it just kind of flourished from there.
They're also working at the club for a while. Put it together for Dave Regnier.
I recently pulled out of my closet the best piece of electronic equipment ever made, the original Nintendo. The only piece of electronic equipment, if it's fucking broke, you can fix it by doing this. Like I was saying, murderers have to be in shape, I swear to God. You're reading the newspapers. Joe Smith stabbed 61 times. Do this 61 times and see where you're at. If I was a murderer, it'd be like... So I recently got back from New York, and I was on the subway, and I was checking my phone and stuff, and I could see there was a black guy looking at me, and I think he was thinking I was checking sports scores or stuff like that. I was confused. I didn't know what he was talking about. He came over, and he was like, "Hey, man, do you know if the Yankees won?" And I was like, "Yeah, man, they won a long time ago. You're free. Remember, only you can fix your Nintendo. You have the right fucking blow, remember that? I mean, two popsicle sticks going in the bag. Don't fucking touch it. It's perfect."
What did you think when Dave told you he wanted to make this movie?
Actually, very surprised. How did they inspire him to make this movie? And he said, I heard the guy made a movie, my date with Drew. So I decided to go on my date with Hugh. And I was surprised when he told me that. I said, go for it.
Great. Has he shown any interest in movies before?
No, not really. No, he hasn't. Let's come up my date with Drew, and he got something in his mind, and he went for it.
AM 1220, 20 minutes before 7 o'clock. This is Cornwall Today. I'm John Bolton.
It is Mahler and Rush, Jenny and Josie, your morning hot tub. We got Dave here with his movie that he is putting together as we speak, My Date with Hugh.
It's 8:08, the early show. It's Drew and Jamie, 15 degrees. Right now we've got a high of 32 with sunshine. Playboy, now that we've got your attention. We're actually talking about Playboy. Dave Regnier is here. He's a comedian. He's a local guy. He's from Cornwall, and he's making a movie. It's called My Date with Hugh. How's it going, Dave?
Pretty good. What's going on, guys?
Well, we're pretty interested in this movie that you're making here, My Date with Hugh.
Believe it or not, I thought of the idea in the bathtub.
Time out. You're a 30-year-old guy. What are you doing in the bathtub?
Well, we have a nice tub that has jets and stuff. Okay. Bubble bath.
Or interview number what, 160?
164, something. I think, yeah.
I'm a big Hugh Hefner fan. I didn't know that he was associated with Playboy, but my question for you is, are you also a big Wolverine fan?
Dude, that's Hugh Jackman.
What?
Well, I think of My Date with Drew. I think of another movie like Super Size Me that
exactly
was really made by an independent filmmaker. Now, do you have any background in filmmaking at
I
all?
I don't, not at all. I'm a comedian.
So you had no acting experience, no writing a movie experience, you don't know how to work a camera really, anything like that?
These are not good things.
No, not when you're going on to make a movie.
Right.
I've obviously taken tons of drama classes, read 300 script writing books, but a documentary, none of that really comes into play.
Right.
Really, I just jumped in like with both feet.
What will you ask Hugh when you meet him, and how are you going to feel? He'll be there in his satin pajamas, and you'll get a chance to shake his hand.
I have no idea. It would just, that's the part that I'm still thinking about. What am I going to say when I meet Hugh?
How about a timeline? When can we expect this out?
I want it all finished basically by the end of September, I think, is when we're going to get the invite. Then basically it's time to pitch.
Experience.
To some production companies. I already got a couple emails from them, but I told them wait till I'm done and I'll contact you guys.
You in?
Hey.
Hey. So this turned out to be something else.
Yeah.
Here's the ad that I replied to. We're looking for an experienced video editor or a senior film student to edit a highly anticipated documentary. Hi, my name is Kevin Burke. I'm a filmmaker from Toronto, Ontario. I was wondering if I might be able to be contacted with the publicity department at Playboy or with someone in the publicity department.
This documentary has already seen nationwide exposure. The film stars big Canadian celebs mixed with some well-known U.S. celebrities.
Okay, so this is an email that I sent late last night at about 3 in the morning to Brett Wilson from the Dragon's Den. I'm going to call Chorus Entertainment. I'm going to give a call to this guy, Brian Herzlinger.
We're actually offering some ownership of the film in return for editing work. Please apply with a resume and a link to some of your work. Serious inquiries only. And then I sit down and I find out that we've got the footage. He doesn't get into the Playboy Mansion. Mm-hmm. There's no... who's going to buy? You can't sell that movie to a distributor.
Actually, the best way to contact that department is to visit playboy.com.
It can sell... We can set it up to have it sell. It really, like I said, it's dependent on Dave.
I'm going to give a call to Judy Bobka of Cornwall.
Hello?
Hello, could I speak with Mr. Regnier, please? Hi, David. I was wondering if I could speak with Leanne, please. Hello, Dave? I'm just calling because I wanted to set up an interview with you today.
Yeah, 5:30 will work.
Hello?
Hello, could I speak with Judy, please?
A lot of people who seem to think that because he's made these errors, that he should go to hell in a handbasket, never to return.
If you get any calls pertaining to what's going on, or if you make any calls pertaining to what's going on, record them. Try to make them from your home phone, and then with your other hand, if possible, videotape with your iPhone kind of thing, right? I think this at this point is the story that sells, and we clear your name and we get we get everybody what they want. We get the film finished, we get it sold, we get the investors back their money, and we get these charges wiped away.
Sounds good.
Well, I'm not quite sure that I'm positive there wasn't the intention to cause distress for anybody.
We're going to give you a facial.
Okay.
We're going to get rid of the blackheads and just
make
sure...
I have blackheads?
Well, okay. Just make sure that your skin looks fresh and clean and okay. Lively. And, well, we got to put a bandana on you.
A bandana?
Yeah. Sorry.
No problem.
We got to get your hair out of the way. Actually, I got to go all the way down. There we go. That's good.
Now you look good, dude.
Okay.
It's looking good, eh? Just steaming a little bit, so not too bad.
Just a little bit.
And yes, I'll let you breathe.
Does it hurt, Dave?
No, it's okay. You
look like something out of The Exorcist.
The Exorcist?
Oh no, it's gonna get better.
When it hardens?
Close your eyes, please.
Oh god.
Snacks!
And, you know, maybe a little bit of a waxing thing going on, just to clean you up here and there, and
oh my god.
This part doesn't hurt, Dave. This part does.
Want to hold my hand?
A little bit.
No! Oh!
What?
How'd that feel?
It felt great.
That was good?
Yeah.
You do that again?
No, not in a million years.
We're going to go with a bit of a manicure and pedicure.
I'm still getting my foot soaked, or feet soaked.
You're not.
Really?
You're good to go, yeah.
Okay, here's my foot. This is weird. Have you ever done this before?
Yeah, all the time.
Oh, really? Okay. I just
no.
Didn't feel like you're rubbing up. Really? You haven't? Oh, God. This is weird.
Just joking.
I could get used to this, though.
Sarah is applying some sort of sandpaper to my nails. Get a grinder out.
That's probably another bald spot.
Mike, you have a bald spot?
No. She created one.
Okay, I'll pull this. Good luck, Dave, on your quest!
Sounds great. appreciate that. Thank you very much. Sounds perfect. Sounds great. Thanks a lot, Brian. I'll see you tomorrow then. All right. You'll meet him tomorrow. His name's Mike. Yeah. Sounds good. Later. Bye.
Is that true? We got an interview with Brian?
Yeah, tomorrow at 12 p.m. at Starbucks on the corner of Ventura and Lot Avenue. He gave me the directions, and he's giving me an hour.
No way.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, way to go, Dave.
I got to make other phone calls, so. Wow.
That's great. So you got to think of some questions there, buddy.
I do.
Good, how you doing? Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Welcome to sunny LA.
Yeah, sunny
LA. Oh, he's already taping.
Yeah. Hey, Brian, how are you?
Nice to meet you.
Good.
Nice to meet you, man.
Nice to meet you,
too. Hi, everybody watching My Date with Hugh.
So one of the reasons I wanted to come to LA was to hopefully meet this one person. Basically, the guy inspired my movie, had a little movie called, you see it on my website, My Date with Drew. And surprisingly enough, he actually agreed to meet with me.
I have to say that I'm flattered that you use our movie as a template and it inspired you at least in somewhat to go after your dream.
I appreciate that.
Which is, I think, a universal dream of all men, to get to the Playboy Mansion. What do you want to do when you get to the mansion? That's my question for you.
See, a lot of people think the first thing they think of is the girls. You're going for the girls, hey, you're going for the girls. But that's completely not it. I just want to, you never hear of it. It's always celebrities, supermodels that get into the mansion. How does just a normal, regular guy do it?
That's a very good question.
So I'm going to meet Hugh. I just want to shake his hand and basically say that I was in his house.
You're taking it upon yourself to be the crusader.
I am.
That solves this riddle. That answers this universal question. How do I, average so-and-so, get into the Playboy Mansion,
exactly.
The epitome of cool?
Yeah.
I'd say you just go and knock. Have you done that?
Well, there's big gates, eh?
You have to try. I'm going to quote something.
Okay.
It's a quote from a lovely young lady. It says, if you don't take risks, you have a wasted soul. What do you have to lose, besides a slight case of incarceration, by knocking on his door?
Nothing, that's it. Plus it'd be a good thing to spend a night in jail in LA.
I can't believe you haven't done it yet.
I would say that don't stop until you get your answer, whether it's a yes or no, no matter what happens. I mean, you're going to wind up, it's a roller coaster ride.
Yeah. This is where Brian was when he found out he got the date. He's talking on the phone. He's like, really, really? You see his eyes start to tear up. And he sits right here, he's singing, and he jumps up and he's like, oh my god, I can't believe, and he's telling people as they walk by, car pulls up right here, and he gets the guy to roll down his window, and he's like, I got a date with Drew Barrymore. He's like, Drew Barrymore? And he's like, yeah, I got a date with him. He's like, congratulations, and he shakes his hand. That happened right here.
Okay, it's 11 o'clock at night, Dave's gone to the washroom, and I'm gonna sock him one with this hair when he comes out.
It was. It was.
I'm actually wondering, Mike, if I could interview you about that.
We used to make jokes about Mike. We used to have poker night all the time at my friend's house. We used to make jokes like we'd call Mike, and Mike would be like, well, it's my 20th wedding anniversary. I'll be there in 10 minutes.
I'm a victim, pretty much like everyone else. He used me to get to my friends and my family.
We always get along great when the two of us are alone. We always have laughs.
I think this guy deserves jail time. He deserves, and this was a good friend of mine. You speak to me a year ago, and I'd be telling you different.
All the negative stuff started coming out. I think he believed most of it, kind of without giving me the benefit of the doubt. And I admit it, I made a lot of mistakes, but I really did, really, really did want to help him.
It was great, we had a good time, but
You know, this is supposed to be a comedy. Hello, my name is Mike, and I'm the original cameraman for My Date With You. And here we are, you know, I'm watching a video of Dave crying, and I'm choked up, and it just doesn't make sense. This is supposed to be a comedy documentary. I'm supposed to be behind the camera. Dave's supposed to be sitting here. Hugh Hefner's supposed to be sitting there. None of that is true because of what Dave done.
What the hell? Fucker. Well, we're at the front gate of the Playboy Mansion. Obviously, they're not going to let us in because they don't know directly who we are. Just going through the radio station. But, I don't know, security guard came on and said that obviously we gotta go through public relations, but we tried. We're at the front gates. This is it right here. This address, 10236 Charing Cross Road. So, I wish I could have got the talking to the security guard. See the funny rock with the speaker in it? So, Hugh. I was wondering if you were going to invite me over soon. I don't know if you know, I'm making a little documentary about you. Oh, speechless. So I know, strong silent type. Alright, well, you know where I am.
And?
There it is! Want to watch it?
Yeah, damn right.
Oh.
Turn it up. Hey, Oz. Let's watch it again.
Hey, Dave. Tell everyone what we're doing here today.
We are in this lovely kind of forest here in... right outside of my hometown. We are putting together a small pitch for, it's kind of like an investment show where you go on and pitch these people ideas and they give you money for your ideas. We're trying to get some extra cash for the film just to help us out a little bit, because a little extra money never hurts. All right, one take. Hey, Dragons. My name's Dave Regnier. I'm a comedian / filmmaker. Now, I know a lot of people come to you pitching ideas and inventions. Well, I'm pitching another thing, a movie. Let me give you a little idea of what's happening. Take a look at this trailer, and I'll be right back to you. So what'd you think of that? Gives you more of an idea about the film. Now, fucker. I like go to talk, and it's like meow, 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 meow. So what'd you think about that? You must be wondering too, who's this person in front of me holding a camera? This is my friend / cameraman, Mike. He's been documenting the journey from Cornwall, Ontario, Canada, all the way to Hollywood, California, to where the Playboy Mansion. What? I got all the way there. That's okay though, I can rewind it, keep the beginning.
Yeah, okay, just keep going.
Okay.
So Dragons?
Go.
Wow, move your fingers out of the way. So, Dragons, what I need from you is an investment of $10,000. And what I give you in return is 10% of the theater sales. And if you remember, my date with Drew made $9 million. So what's 10% of that?
Tonight on Dragon's Den, Dave Regnier and Mike Pilon from Cornwall, Ontario need $10,000 to finish their film about getting into the Playboy Mansion. Now, they just have to get past the Dragon's own velvet rope to secure a deal.
Hi, Dragons. My name is Dave Renning. This is my friend Mike Pilon. We're from Cornwall, Ontario. And my product is called My Date with Hugh. We're looking for a $10,000 investment for 10% of the profits. This is the end of the movie, and these are some of the actors that are in the film.
Guaranteed?
Guaranteed. For free. How you doing? My name is Dave Regnier.
Before he continues, Dave shows a clip of his documentary about the comic lengths he went through to meet Hugh Hefner inside the Playboy Mansion.
Good luck, Dave, on your quest.
He traveled across North America to interview celebrities, endured physical pain, all to enter its hallowed gates. Now he needs 10 grand to get it into theaters.
So your whole point here, if I can get it right, is to get in to see Hugh Hefner.
That's exactly. The end of the story. That's it. Shake his hand, ask him a couple questions, and...
Why can't you raise $10,000 from family and friends?
Search my date with Hugh. But here's an article from July entitled Comic Not So Funny to Kin. Among those who feel taken by Regnier are two family members, his uncles Robert and Richard Regnier, who invested in one of his projects. Between them, Regnier's uncles claim they put up $69,500 for their nephew's documentary film, My Date with Hugh.
We filmed coming here in the car. We did it as a drive for footage.
That makes sense.
I could have just got a credit card and maxed it out.
The fact that you thought through the PR side of it to actually come here to get the $10,000 you need, and that you filmed that, and that's part of the whole story. The PR
if I could film right
is
now,
very
I would,
smart.
But...
I mean,
yeah,
you,
there's no tape.
They won't allow us.
They made us open the camera and show.
Like many other investors, I've had the experience of investing in films, which is an absolutely crap investment.
Right, it can be.
And it was. It was. Thank you,
Dave. I'll give you $25,000 for 50%. That's a great offer, but I'll top it.
What's the topping it?
$25,000 for 25%. That's in line with your 10 for 10, and all of these people can participate. Take the cash. Dave, I'll give you $50,000 for 50%.
I'll go into the 50 for 50% deal. I'll do that.
Anybody else in on that? Jim?
I'll go in with that.
Dave has split the Dragons into two competing camps. Robert, Kevin, and Jim are offering $50,000 for 50%. Brett's bidding $25,000 for 25%. And Dave only came asking for a meager 10 grand.
I think that the right deal for you is to not give up 50% of this company. I was happy at 10 for 10, but I'm a little bit greedy, so I offered you 25 for 25. The greed factor got carried away with some of my colleagues, and I understand that.
But
they've
Brett,
got to make a living,
a
too.
Why be a bozo and compete with us? On. Why be a bozo?
Well, I was first.
Dave,
listen,
these guys are all, they're going to tell you that they've got all these businesses and they're involved in it all. They know this about marketing. In fact, they don't even believe in it. So I
And how many films have you marketed? How many films have you marketed?
I actually have marketed.
Zero.
No,
how many films have my children
watched? My friend, I have marketed films, and I'm with him because why would you give up more? And I think the 25 is all you
need. You got one deal at $50,000 for 50% from Jim, Kevin, and I, and you have the other deal at a very, very lowly $25,000.
And let's remember that you got to make your movie because people believed in you, and they did a lot of stuff without a cent being spent. So you partner with the people that are going to be treating you the right way.
Yeah, I just wear a t-shirt. That's why I'm keeping this not, I don't know how to dress.
Well,
like Brett's fancy dressing.
I know.
And you're fancy dressing.
No, you know, I think for our sake, you should take the dress shirt off and we should see the real Dave.
But there's a lot of real Dave right here that I'm not showing to. This kind of hides it a little bit that I'm showing, so...
Arlene?
That's not good.
All right, let's get her done.
It was good. Thanks a lot, guys. I'm excited. We were actually doing okay. We had a lot of footage, but obviously going on a show like Dragon's Den, it brought up a lot of opportunity to get even more footage. Being on a show like that that's watched by so many people, I was able to film with a bunch of Canadian celebrities.
people like Russell Peters, Jerry D. It brought me to, he's not Canadian, but it brought me to Carrot Top. Obviously, after being on the show, we were able to, we had a lot more opportunities to get better footage.
Whoa!
So?
What's going on?
Are you ready to go to Playboy Mansion, Dave?
I guess so. That's the plan. Yeah, I'm ready. My ball's over here.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Great, how are you, love?
I'm doing great, how you doing?
Fantastic.
I've been keeping myself up to date on you by going to the website mydatewithhugh.com and trying to monitor where exactly you've been, and it appears that you're getting close.
It's getting very close. It's getting close, so close that it's kind of almost like a tease. Playboy called me. I finally got a call.
That's amazing.
I know, they know about the project.
And you've got this film... 90%, would you say
90%
of the way done?
I would say a lot of the footage is complete. I'm still getting, another idea, what I had is, I'm like, let me get other celebrities' experiences on their experience at the Playboy Mansion. Dave speaking.
Hey, Dave, this is Carrot Top.
Hey, Carrot Top, how you doing?
I'm awesome, how you doing?
I'm doing okay. I appreciate you doing this so much.
Oh, no problem, not a problem.
It's kind of nice to have, you're pretty much the reason why I started doing comedy.
Really?
Yeah. I've been a fan of yours since high school. Now, being a full-time comedian myself, you're the one why I started. I mean, so, like, when I do get in, what should I do?
I would run right up the stairs and start looting.
That's it? Just steal as much stuff as I can in the Playboy Mansion?
Just take as much Viagra as you can.
Well, that's perfect. I appreciate it again, Carrot Top. Thanks a lot.
No problem, Dave. We'll see you soon.
Yeah, sounds great. See you later.
All right, bye.
Cool.
That was awesome.
How cool is that?
Except he swore a couple times. It's a PG-13 movie. You don't understand. To have your comedy idol call me to be in my movie to give his insight on going to the Playboy Mansion.
And that's exactly where we're going.
You know what I mean? How can I... Oh.
That's awesome.
That's fantastic. We have a trip coming up. We do not have enough money to go on this trip. And it's a pretty crucial trip for the film. I got $500 here. I need to at least double this to go on this trip. So we thought, what the hell? I'm going to go in here. Bet it on red or black, and just try. Just go for it.
Good luck, Dave! He doesn't look happy. Oh, shit. Yes! We got enough? You did it!
Adult film star, reality film star, normal film star, just a normal, everyday
life. I'll take all the above.
Yeah.
No one's going to believe it's really me anyway. They're going to say, is that my Jeremy working a dumbbell?
I'm actually sitting here with the gorgeous adult film star, Nikki Benz. The king, Jerry Lawler. Hey, Jerry, how's it going?
That's good. Glad to have you here.
Thank you very much.
At the home of the real king. Well, the only king that's left, you know what I mean?
You know, women are allowed to go and bring a girlfriend.
Yeah.
It is very, very tough to bring a male friend.
I hear that at the parties, there are just big goblets full of Viagra all over the...
Somebody else told me that, too.
Yeah, that I'd like to grab by the handfuls, you know.
I don't know. If you imagine a handful of that, you'd probably pass out.
Nothing else has that mystique, you know? Even though I'm sure Brad Pitt is very famous, but no one's going to go, I'm at Brad Pitt's home.
Right.
Well, yeah, I'd say that too. But the mansion is like just that thing of going to the mansion, you know?
Yeah.
I'm a firm believer in life that, you know, when you really try hard, you really persevere, and you hustle, give it everything you got, things might happen for you.
I'll make sure I'm wearing jeans.
Yeah.
Something that if something does happen.
No khakis.
No. Or jogging pants. Well, really, anyone that wears jogging pants.
No, you only wear those to a strip club.
But sure. The look, I might need, I don't know if I could pull this nice.
That's just a suit, Dave.
Yeah, but I don't know.
Isn't there a men's warehouse in Canada?
There is, but it'd be like the big and tall.
You can get one that fits.
If he invited me to go save them, I would take advantage of every perk.
So you're not worried about being invited back a second time. I'll just roll the dice and shoot the works for the first time.
Yeah. Well, my advice is pretty decent also. Now, you have a choice. Over there is LAX Airport, and over there is Burbank Airport. Like, this is probably happening to call you right now. Over there is LAX, and there's Burbank.
Yeah.
And I think you probably should take the next flight out. Because they're your odds.
We got the call that you either agreed or got shoved into doing this interview with
it's
me.
Both.
And I'm here with Russell Peters. Can you believe it? Now I've got my two favorite comedians in the film.
Who's the first one?
Well, for you, you're the first one, but Carrot Top's number two.
Did you have to say he's your favorite because he's in it?
I have my three favorite comedians in my movie.
That. He's just saying that.
I'm not just saying that. I got Carrot Top.
Nice.
Russell Peters.
Good.
And Jerry D.
Hanson. I don't fit in that group.
Let's say Hugh Hefner gave you a call and said, Russell, come down to the Playboy Mansion and do a comedy show.
Well, I would say, what am I being paid in?
What if you said, like, Playmates?
I'll be there in a minute.
Get a hot girlfriend. That's what I would do. I would rent a girl.
Okay.
Like a girl that's like a Playboy looking. And
Playboy
maybe
looking.
you can say she's you can either lie, say she's already in a magazine, make up a year.
Okay.
Let's say
1964.
Now she's Miss November 2007. Just
okay.
Quick, a little bit distant. In case the guy at the security has the magazines in front of him.
And he's going.
He won't have 2007.
No, he shouldn't.
No, that's like 2 years, almost a year.
Yeah. By the
time this airs, 6 years.
The more hot ladies, the better.
Yeah. Yes.
Definitely.
Yeah. That will get your foot in the door.
And those shoes.
I just got the call from Playboy, and they passed. I don't understand. I put everything into this movie for the last 2 years. All I did was promote them and talk good about Playboy for the last 2 years in every interview that I did, and now they do this to me. I gave them everything they wanted. Everything. I don't understand why they would do this. I'm sending another email right now to see if I can get something else. I don't know, another answer. I can't. I can't do it. Like, well, it's a couple days after Playboy said no, and isn't this a kick in the pants? Look what I get in the mail. I forgot about these. Well, not much I can really do.
Well, I'm trying to email Playboy again. This is email 60, maybe, somewhere around there, that they haven't responded to. Send an email. I sent an email. That's how easy it is. Send an email back. I've never met a company that is this, I don't know, they're so not touched with reality. It's ridiculous. But I need that ending.
You want to be in this?
How's that? Yeah. You talk back to me once in a while? Then... I'm not talking to the audience. I've never talked to the audience once the whole movie. I'm always talking to Mike. Hi, I'm Dave Regnier from My Date with Hugh. I have the interview with Hugh Hefner today.
I'm sorry, say that one more time.
Dave Regnier from My Date with Hugh, the documentary.
Hold on 1 second.
No problem. Security rock. Very secure.
I'm sorry, what's your name again?
Dave Regnier. R-E-G-N-I-E-R. And it's for My Date with Hugh.
Who's your contact?
Like Rob Hilberger and stuff like that.
So what happened?
We're not getting in. I don't understand. Actually, turn that off for a minute, please. Just turn it off. Rory, turn the fucking camera off for a minute. Thank you.
I don't think I want it anymore. It's too hard. Please put it out. I don't think it's near my place yet.
Basically, the only way to sell this is to accept the fact that the story of this documentary has changed. It's a story about a guy who has never made a film before, who got a big break, and everything collapses on him. A probe into Cornwall comedian Dave Regnier's financing of film projects is growing, while at the same time getting closer to home. The Cornwall Police Department's lead fraud investigator, Detective Constable Scott Virtue, confirms that Regnier is under investigation. As reported earlier by the Standard Freeloader on May 26th, a number of investors in Regnier's projects feel like they've been taken for a ride after putting money into projects such as a film called Celebrity. "We have no idea how big this is," Robert said, referring to how many places complaints are coming from. Virtue confirmed that there are complaints from Peterborough, Toronto, London, Belleville, Brockville, Kingston, and Ottawa, while another was received from someone who lived in the area before moving to Prince Edward Island. Cornwall comic faces 41 counts of fraud. Police say $170,000 raised for Celebrity documentary is missing. Regnier, 34, who had been living in Toronto, turned himself in to the Cornwall police and was charged Tuesday with 41 counts of fraud in connection with his films My Date with Hugh and Celebrity.
200% of the film has been paid up. Promised.
200% of the film My Date with Hugh has already been promised?
And then some. The paper, the newspaper article that you're reading, says about $170,000. We figure it's close to about $500,000 if you included that.
I just wanted to do something positive, so I thought that I would get some family and friends to invest in my project. I thought it would give me a kick in the pants to kind of work hard too, but the dates and the pressure that I put on myself, and I made it unrealistic for me to get it completed. So I found myself getting other investors to pay off the other investors, and it just was a vicious circle. It just kept going, and I couldn't. And yeah, I did tell some lies to some family and friends to buy myself time. I didn't know how to get out of it.
Yes, I just started a brand new job, and I had to weigh things out. It's not like I have been there for a long time, but I weighed things out saying, listen, what do I do? Do I actually hop on board and help Dave here and get this thing done? Or do I do it when I can part-time? Well, obviously the interviews had to be scheduled on certain dates, so part-time wasn't gonna happen. So I did it. I took the plunge where none of his other friends would.
Mike got paid to do this film. Not a lot, but at the time he was having trouble. He was trying to think whether or not he could quit his job and work on the film. And he actually ended up losing his job. So with some of the money from Dragon's Den, I don't remember how long it was for, 3 or 4 months maybe, I was giving him money just to help to pay his bills.
Mike thinks he's contributed a whole heap to Dave's livelihood, and Dave seems to think that he's helped Mike a fair amount. I'm not sure if either of them really recognize that they've both helped each other along the way.
You say to elaborate, but he would present an unrefusable contract.
what I thought, I was making Celebrity, and that's the other film, and I wanted to do some kind of publicity stunts.
Showed that he won a comedy award, and who am I to question different? When a friend says, hey, look what I won, you pat him on the shoulder and say, wow, congratulations. You know, hey, guess what? I'm writing for Saturday Night Live. Oh, really? Saturday Night Live? Yeah, I'm going to be going there, and it's going to look great on my resume. And oh, wow, pat him on the back again. That's great. Good job.
The same media that took my publicity stunts and, without checking the facts, put them in their newspaper and ran with the story. I knew I could go to them because I knew they wouldn't check the facts, and I knew they would just help me along with this publicity stunt. They weren't done to try to trick people into giving me money. I understand now how it looks and how the media flip-flopped it, and to say that I'm a big fraud and all this stuff.
I know what he's done to me, and I know what he's done to my close friends and my family. I see what he's done to his own family. I live in Cornwall. He's escaped from Cornwall. He's gone to Toronto now, so he left all this behind.
I left Cornwall because everything that was coming out about me, I knew that I had to finish the film.
So every time I walk into a grocery store or walk into a restaurant, I bump into someone with questions about this whole charges or the whole movie or what's going on. Oh, I seen you on Dragon's Den. I seen that. He escaped from all that, and I'm putting up with it now.
There's no one in Cornwall that could help me get this completed, and I desperately, desperately had to get this completed, and that was the project, the only project that I've been working on since I moved here.
We did say at the meeting that Mike would help to sell the film with Dave's okay, and then it seemed as if, I think I was told that Mike didn't really approach anybody to sell it because he didn't like the consistency or the, not consistent, the state of the film. Said he couldn't sell it.
I think the whole documentary has been, like when they were shooting it, they're intense. You can tell they were just having fun. It was like they're on vacation. And I mean, they were working towards the goal, but like there's never any kind of talk about the filmmaking process that I see. They just had the schedule and they just thought that they could just capture footage and go from there.
And Dave was arrested for defrauding investors in the film. Yeah, I understand. A few people have told me that. You know what? Can you just give me Hefner's direct line? I'm kidding. Hello?
There still is a process. It is still a profession. And people do go to school for it, and people do spend some time training.
Okay, No, I know that's what everybody says, but if there's any way that you can help me, it's not just for me. If you can help me and help the... Is there a number for that office? You can't. Okay. Thank you. My date with Drew was a shot in the dark. That doesn't happen to everybody who picks up a camera, and I think that Dave knows that now.
I thought it was going to be so fun to do it, and this project turned out to be the best and worst thing I've ever done in my life. I don't know. I don't think I want it anymore. I think I just want a normal job, just a 9-to-5.
Hello, Mr. Regnier?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Kevin Burke. I'm not sure if Dave has mentioned me. I'm a friend of his. I'm working to finish his film.
In March of last year, actually lost everything in a house fire.
Oh God, please put it out.
Was left with basically the sweater on my back and the jeans I had on. I just obviously having the pressure on me that I did with two films and house burning down and things like that, things just got out of control and I couldn't handle them.
It's gotta be really hard to watch your son go through something like this.
Yeah, it's just tearing my heart out.
It's caused me to lose relationships. Just recently my girlfriend Jess is moving to her sister's to kind of get away from the stress of all of it, and again, it's my fault.
I'm not sure everybody would cope. I think Dave's been able to grow personally through this experience that has not very much pleasant about it.
Can you look at me for a second, Dave? Do you understand that if we can't salvage this film, there's a very good chance that you're going to go to jail?
Yeah, I know. I know that.
Do you think that that's something that you can handle?
No. Not at all.
Mike, do you think that Dave belongs in jail?
Yeah, I do. I honestly do. Without a doubt, actually. I think that what he's done is wrong. And no matter how much he's trying to make it right now, if I stole your car and then gave it back, I still stole your car. It's wrong, and I think you should be punished for it.
Representatives of Playboy and Mr. Hefner, if by some miracle you're seeing this appeal right now, it will at least mean that we've succeeded in doing everything that we possibly can to try and salvage this film and save these investors their money. I know that you initially gave a negative response to Dave. I feel it's important for you to know that this film is no longer just about Dave Regnier. This movie is about small town people from all over Ontario. People with families. People who just wanted to be a part of something bigger than themselves. People who just wanted to be a part of making a movie. The only way that we can make things right for these people is by selling the film and including a dynamic ending would really help us to do that. You don't owe anyone anything. Your publication is revered all over the world. You've made leaps and bounds in anti-censorship and freedom of speech areas. I only ask that you consider, one way or another, providing us with any response to help him finish this movie. Thank you very much.
Yeah, right now we're at Films in Toronto, and it's our first meeting with a distributor. We're going to hand them the DVD. Chat with them for a bit, and then they're probably going to watch it, and then let us know what they think.
You think it's going to work out?
I hope so, man. Well, this is the first one, so if it works on the first one, then I'll be pretty happy.
Well, we sent some copies to distributors. We did get one pass. What I'm doing is I'm putting distributors in the back of my mind and focusing on, I guess, film festivals to start, because at least that we can control. We can control filling out the applications and sending DVDs to them. Waiting for distributors to contact us back, we can't. Like, it would drive me crazy to just sit here and wait for that. So I guess I'm working towards, I guess, some sort of little goals, working up to the main goal, and that's paying back the investors. The first film festival we're applying for is Hot Docs. It's based here in Toronto. In my opinion, in many opinion, it's probably the number one documentary film festival there is in North America. The only problem with this is, when do they ask for the credit card?
Oh, I don't know.
Because I can't, I have to go, like, my real credit card, I canceled them, so I wouldn't use them, because I'm having such a hard time with money. I know that I have myself in debt with them, so I only have one of those prepaid ones for Money Mart.
So we gotta go pick one up?
No, I have one. I just have to go put money on it. Money Mart's just right here on Yonge.
The story should be told. The truth should be told. And it should not just be told by one person. Several people should tell it.
I'd like to see the film sell, and that the investors can be compensated.
In the end of the movie, I just want people to come out and start asking a lot of questions.
Right, well, actually, you made Dave's dad very happy tonight.
Well, I'm happy that I could.
Many of the investors will never be happy unless they get the return on their investment. Some of the investors are going to be happy if they get their investment back. And others will be happy to get something. So I'd like to see it sell for a huge amount of money. That would be wonderful. It's just crazy to think that he could just live on other people's money. And if he says his intentions for this movie was to make everybody their money back, why was it shelved for so long? Why do you just, when the shit hits the fan, pull it off the shelf now and say, oh, okay, well, now I'll finish the movie so I could get everybody their money back? And their money back, that's not what they invested for. They invested because they want to make money.
Today's Christmas Day, 2012. I was always hoping that after the holidays, this was gonna get a lot better for me. In 3 days, I gotta turn myself in to the Coburg police now, because there's an investor in Cornwall, or in Coburg, and he made a complaint as well. I know that I screwed up in a major way. I know I made mistakes. Being alone on Christmas Day is not something I would ever wish upon my worst enemy. It's such an awful, awful feeling of just emptiness. I just need this to come to an end. I can't keep dealing with this. I just can't. It's too much.
To walk.